In this video, I'm going to talk about multicorder, a great feature within vMix, which allows you, if you want to edit your remote guest interviews, which you've captured using vMix call. Well, multicorder allows you to leverage higher quality recordings and introduce more editing flexibility into your post-production workflow. That's coming right up. Hello again, world. Carlos here from Feel Good Footage. I'm a producer, director, and content creator working in London. And my channel, Feel Good Footage, is all about how to create better content. Whether that's equipment, workflow, or techniques, I want to help you make better content. So if that sounds interesting, well, consider subscribing. Since I came across vMix for the first time last year, I've become a really big fan of the product. I think it's really powerful software, competitively priced, easy to use, and from what I can tell, has got some really good guys running the company, people who are very keen to stay in close contact with their user base and always keep striving to improve the product. Now, one of the best things with vMix is vMix Call. It's built-in remote guest live interview solution. Now, vMix Call leaves alternatives such as trying to capture a remote guest interview via a Zoom call. Well, it leaves those sort of alternatives a long, long way behind in terms of functionality and, critically for me, the quality of the audio and video you can obtain using vMix call. If you're running a live production, a vMix call becomes one of your inputs. And just like any other input, you can then cut to and from that at will, bringing it in and out of the program output. And if you're running vMix Pro, well, that means that you could have up to 8 different vMix callers coming in as remote guests coming into your production. Last year, I used vMix for a client job where we had 6 remote callers for the live stream. And I was just so grateful that I'd come across vMix, as the project would have been a nightmare without it. Have a look at my clip on the workflow if you're interested. I think it stands to reason that the vast majority of times people are using vMix, it will be a live environment. It is a live production switcher. However, there will be times perhaps when you will use vMix and vMix call and you are not live. For example, perhaps you want to conduct a remote guest interview and pre-record that ahead of time using vMix call. Or perhaps you do want to hold a remote guest interview using vMix call and send that straight into your stream live. But after the fact, after you've stopped going live, you want to return to that interview and you want to re-edit it, most likely make it a lot shorter. Of course, if you bring a remote guest into your live production using vMix call, you can record any interview you have with them as part of your master, your program output. But of course, the recording of the program master will reflect exactly what your camera switches, your input switches were during the interview. So you may have the whole interview as a side-by-side shot of a host and the remote guest who's coming in via vMix call. Or it could be switching to a single of the guest or a single of the host, but typically you won't have more than that. The audio as well will be pulled. It will be sent to the program master output, unless of course you've set a separate audio bus recording to be made of any given input, but that's another step you'd need to take, and we won't talk about that during this clip. The point is, if you want to re-edit that interview after the fact and use just the program master recording, you will only ever have as part of that recording what you were switched to during the live record of that interview. However, vMix does allow you to make a simultaneous recording of those inputs. So afterwards, you would have a clean or isolated recording of, say, the host and the guest, both their video and their audio. This feature is called multicorder, and I think it's absolutely genius. I used it recently on a booking I was brought in for, and I'll discuss that more fully in a moment. But first, 2 really important points to bear in mind. First, multicorder is only available on vMix 4K and vMix Pro, the top 2 license options. Second, the exact functionality or performance you can expect from vMix Multicorder will depend on your PC's specification. As a bare minimum, vMix states you will need an SSD to store the recordings, plus an Intel Core i7 quad-core processor or higher with at least 1 GB of onboard memory. Even then, the number of simultaneous recordings and recording formats will depend on your PC's specific capability. For reference, here are the specs for my streaming laptop. On this job, I recorded the program output and two of my inputs via Multicorder. These inputs were my two vMix call guests. So in total, my laptop was recording 3 video streams simultaneously. Until recently, I was using the vMix HD version, which allows just one vMix call and doesn't allow Multicorder. So a couple of days before filming, I upgraded to the 4K version, which is very straightforward and fair. I just had to pay the difference between the two licenses, and now I have another 12 months of upgrades included as well. Again, for me, this is another example of vMix being competitive and customer focused. The setup was we're in London at the host's apartment. Upon arrival, I did a speed test, and from memory, the speed was 60 megabits per second download, 12 megabits per second upload. So not blazing fast, but satisfactory for our needs. Our guest was in Rome. He's a young Italian influencer and musician called Valerio Mazze. And for the interview, he was in his agent's office, I believe. I'm not sure what his internet connection speed was, but we were assured in advance it was adequate. Even though the host was in the room at the same time as us, I decided to bring him into the live production as a vMix call remote guest, even though he was, as I say, just a couple of meters away. I decided to do that rather than capture him on the professional broadcast quality camera I had with me and feed that into the production via HDMI. That would have been the best quality in terms of image quality and also audio if we plumbed in a microphone with the camera as well at the same time. But I decided not to do that, and the reason is very simple. We wanted this interview to be as relaxed, as comfortable, as normal in these somewhat unusual times for both the host and the guest. And both of them are expecting, as an experience, something that's pretty much like a Zoom call. They want to be able to see each other at the time that they are speaking. So if I asked the host to look into a big lens to while he was having the interview, obviously he wouldn't be able to see the reference feed I was sending of the two of them speaking together. He wouldn't be able to see that. He'd be looking down a lens. And if I asked him to look into a monitor that I could send the program master output, where I'd put both the host and the guest on screen at the same time, so he could see himself. Well, if that was a monitor, then his eye line would be wandering. It would be obviously away from the lens. It just doesn't look right when somebody's not looking directly at their lens during the conversation. Plus, I knew for a fact that he was using an iPhone 10, and previously I've tested the quality that you can expect when somebody is using a phone like an iPhone 10, which has a great lens and sensor. I knew that in terms of image quality, even though he was a vMix call guest, the quality would be more than adequate. The guest in Rome connected via vMix call, and that was fairly straightforward. We'd provided very clear instructions beforehand, and the people on the other side were fairly tech savvy. Once the vMix calls were up and running, I just needed to start the recordings. As I say, I would be recording 3 streams. The first was output 1, which was the master you'd usually send to the live stream if this was going live. But in this case, it was what the host and guests saw on their phones as the return feed. This I had at 1920 by 1080, PAL 25p, bitrate 16 megabits per second, audio at 128 kilobits per second. This was simply a side-by-side shot using the vMix Multiview template. It was really just a reference record, as the entire interview would be edited after the fact using the Multicorder files. I set the Multicorder to record both my vMix call inputs. Here again, you have lots of options, and you can go very high quality AVI if you're involved with broadcast television, for example. This was for internet distribution only, so we decided to cut our cloth accordingly. You also need to think about the file size and how much storage space you have on your SSD. Finally, I also considered the fact that vMix call will only allow at maximum up to 720p to be sent from a guest. And that's if their internet connection supports that. Plus, of course, if the device they are connecting with has a camera capable of capturing at least 720p. Now, compared to the dreadful quality remote guest feeds I so often see, even on broadcast television these days, 720p captured in a well-lit environment with a good quality connection is going to look great for a remote guest, in my opinion. So I set the multicorder records for MP4, video bitrate 12 megabits per second, audio 192 kilobits per second, with the audio source for each multicorder set to the input source itself. The main chunk of the interview was about 17 minutes, and each recording created a 1.2 gigabyte file in my multicorder folder. I was really happy with the quality of the recordings, especially the host. I think his image looked superb. A lot of that has to do with the iPhone X camera. However, I did have additional LED lights on him. I also recorded a second camera angle to cut into the edit and add some variety. This was completely standalone and recorded to the camera only. And finally, as a failsafe for the host, we also recorded everything he said to lapel mic, again, going to the camera only. The guest was not quite as clean. I'm not sure what phone he was using or the lighting setup at that end, or indeed the internet connection speed. However, it was perfectly acceptable as a remote guest. Remember, even though it was recorded as a 1920 by 1080 file, the incoming video resolution is 1280 by 720, so it does not fill the frame. If you want to make the video image full frame and remove the black, you need to scale up. However, crucially, the multicorder files captured clean, isolated audio for both the host and the guest. Their audio wasn't mixed with any other source. And having that clean audio is absolutely critical for post-production work. If you have clean, isolated audio from an interview, you can get by and overcome any other problems, usually, that may arise. You can always put some sort of visual overlay on to cover any sort of dropout in video quality, for example. But fortunately, we didn't have any of those problems. But to reiterate a golden rule, any vMix call remote guest, in fact, anyone on any sort of conferencing sort of situation like this, they really need to wear headphones. Even if they're in a quiet location, they need to wear headphones to really minimize the chance of echo or any sort of audio distortion feedback going back into the system, which always sounds so painful to listen to. It's incredibly distracting. Ideally, of course, they should also use an external microphone plugged into to their phone or whatever device they're looking into the little lens of. But in these sort of indoor locations with no other extraneous noise, you can get by without them, but certainly headphones are a must. The conversation was edited to make a 5-minute package for a show I'm working on as a technical producer. If you're interested in viewing that, you can watch this episode of the YouTube show in question. Remember though, even though at first glance it may look like a live stream chat that's been captured as live, it is in fact an edited package using the multicorder files as the rushes and was edited completely afterwards. The background and graphics and camera changes were added in post. Even though I didn't do that post-production work myself, a colleague took care of that. When I was looking at the files to produce this clip, I did find that they were very intensive on my PC at home, my desktop PC, which I use for all my editing. I was using Adobe Premiere Pro. My takeaway from that is I will certainly have a play with the settings I use for my recording, and or I will also transcode any multicorder files that I use in the future before I edit with them. That said, that doesn't stop me being, once again, really impressed by vMix. I do think this multicorder functionality, if you can make use of it, is just so useful in certain situations. If you enjoyed this clip, if you learned something along the way, a like would be fantastic, as would a comment or a question. I try and answer those questions just as soon as I possibly can. Love hearing the feedback to the videos. If you're interested in how to use an external encoder like vMix with something like Microsoft Teams Live Event. Well, take a look at the clip that's on screen right now, where I detail in full the workflow I used to do just that. In the meantime, I wish you every success making great content for yourselves, and thank you for watching.